In the 1940s, psychologist Abraham Maslow first introduced what he called the hierarchy of needs for human motivation. This is basically a framework for understanding how we as humans navigate our most fundamental needs. A key to this hierarchy was that the fulfillment of certain needs is often dependent on the fulfillment of more basic needs. So at the base of this hierarchy, you have physiological needs like air, food, water. Next layer up, you have physical safety like shelter, then love and belongingness, and above that, esteem, including self-esteem. But at the pinnacle of Maslow's original hierarchy was a concept called self-actualization. And this refers to one meeting their full potential as a human, engaged in something that's deeply meaningful to them. Maslow put it this way: what a man can be, he must be. So writers must write, painters must paint, entrepreneurs must build organizations. A key ingredient of self-actualization is the ability to consciously make free decisions for purposeful action in your life. Scientifically, we can call that agency. To what degree are you a creative force? Do you have an influence in this world? Are you an agent, as opposed to behaving passively, falling into habitual behavior? Another aspect of this hierarchy is that we don't necessarily follow these different categories of needs in a fixed order, and we can address more than one category at the same time. So for example, it's possible for someone to spend a small percentage of their motivation focused on self-actualization while still addressing more fundamental needs. It's also possible that just because you've met those more basic needs that you're not necessarily going to be focused on self-actualization. So I'll try a little bit of an experiment here, just based on the description I provided. How many of you, with a show of hands, would say that you spend all of your motivation, or virtually all of it, focused on self-actualization? I hear a lot of laughs, but not a lot of hands. Okay, second question. How many of you would say you spend at least some of your motivation, even if small, focused on self-actualization? Okay, I see some hands popping up there. So this just demonstrates that we do bounce back and forth between these different modes of motivation. For the last 20 years, the focus of my scientific career has been examining the effects of psychedelics in human beings. What are psychedelics? There are probably some suspects that you'll recognize. Psilocybin, the active agent in so-called magic mushrooms. LSD probably needs no introduction. Mescaline, the active agent in the peyote cactus. Dimethyltryptamine, the agent in the South American sacrament, ayahuasca. And MDMA, which is known on the street as Molly or ecstasy. During my 20 years of work with psychedelics, I've come to believe that these psychedelics constitute a powerful technology for maximizing conscious decision making, which could potentially lead to increases in self-actualization. Now, psychedelics have a crazy history. In fact, they're prehistorical. There's evidence that indigenous cultures throughout the globe have used psychedelics for thousands of years. But it wasn't until the 1940s that they became a real interest in science. And then there was a heyday of therapeutic research with psychedelics in the 1950s and 1960s. And during that time, investigators found that LSD and other psychedelics showed real promise in treating terminal cancer patients who were suffering from existential anxiety, because of their impending death, as well as treating alcoholism. But despite these early promising findings, the entire domain of human research with psychedelics was put on deep freeze for decades. And so what was the reason for this backlash? Well, there were a few. It's important to keep in mind that in the mid to late 60s, psychedelic use became pretty popular amongst young people. And amongst that large number of people, there were some real casualties, including people with psychiatric vulnerabilities, people who used recklessly and in unsafe situations. But probably even bigger than that as a cause for the backlash is this association between psychedelics and the counterculture. The cultural influence of psychedelics was pervasive, and music from everyone from the Beatles to Jimi Hendrix, and psychedelics were associated with so many of the social movements of the day, such as the anti-Vietnam War protests, and these things scared a lot of segments of society. Reinforcing that backlash, the public discovered in the 1970s that the CIA, under their project MKUltra, had been conducting clandestine research with psychedelics, including dosing of American citizens without their knowledge or consent. But about 20 years ago, around the time when I started doing work with psychedelics, we stepped into an era that's now come to be known as the Renaissance of human psychedelic research. And this started out with a small number of laboratories around the planet that at first conducted just a very few studies in a tiny number of people. Fast forward to today, things have radically changed. It's probably easier for me to count the number of major medical institutions without a psychedelic research program than it is to count the number of such institutions with a psychedelic research program. There is finally some limited amount of federal funding for therapeutic research with psychedelics. In fact, I was very lucky a few years ago, I received the first federal funding from the US government in about a half century for therapeutic research with some of these classic psychedelics, specifically my work using psilocybin to see if it can treat tobacco addiction. There's also a multi-billion dollar industry now surrounding these psychedelics, with a number of companies moving psychedelics along the FDA pathway, looking towards potential medical approval as medicines. But all of that progress is because of a growing number of clinical trials that have demonstrated that psychedelics often have high rates of efficacy in treating some intractable disorders, including cancer distress, major depressive disorder, anxiety, bipolar 2 disorder, PTSD, and multiple forms of addiction. Now, psychedelic therapy flies in the face of your standard psychiatric treatment paradigm. Rather than taking a pill every day in order to treat symptoms, patients are administered 1, 2, or 3 doses of the psychedelic under careful, monitored supervision. And yet we're seeing improvements in addictive behavior, depression, and PTSD months, and even in some cases, years later. 20 years ago, the frontier of this psychedelic renaissance was determining whether these psychedelics could potentially treat some of these psychiatric disorders. Now, thankfully, there's countless academic groups and companies that are pursuing that medical pathway. That's important work, and it's going to continue. But I'm arguing today that the frontier has moved on. We're missing an elephant in the room. The burning question is, why in the world are these psychedelics and these experiences, why are they able to treat such nominally distinct disorders? What's the commonality? And the biggest thing that jumps out to me and where I think the frontier is at, I believe that psychedelics can maximize conscious, free decision-making, allowing us to step into that mode of self-actualizations, and that's at play in all of these disorders. When people are healed with psychedelics, you know, something really shifts inside of them. I'm going to tell you about a patient experience. 15 years ago or so, I was with a patient that was experiencing a high-dose psilocybin session. And he said he had the insight that, and this was part of a study to see if psilocybin could help with his tobacco addiction, he said he had the insight that his addiction to cigarettes was like a small bug that had landed on him. And he said he could just flick it off easily. And he said, I know this sounds stupid, but I can just decide to quit smoking. I can decide to quit smoking. And I've come to call these duh experiences. And you see quite a bit of these in these psychedelic sessions. You know, okay, you know, yeah, you can quit smoking. Yeah, you've decided to quit smoking before and it hasn't worked out. The reason I call them duh experiences is because the person themselves knows that it sounds trite, that it sounds hollow. But they're feeling something profound that they're not able to fully express in words. In fact, we even have a fancy scientific term for that. We say that these psychedelic experiences can be ineffable. It's when the person says that no matter how hard they try to describe the magnitude of this experience, they can't come anywhere close to fully capturing it. But even though these experiences are often ineffable, we as scientists kind of like to try to F that up by asking the patients to do their best to describe the experiences. But an important point about this is that this wasn't a fleeting insight. He felt just as strongly about this insight in the days and the weeks following the session. And that helped him quit smoking. When people are successfully treated for these various disorders with psychedelics, they change their belief in themselves. There's an increase in their belief that they can change their own behavior and thoughts. Whether it's abandoning a decades old addiction, or whether that's changing the way you've come to think about yourself in the context of depression, or changing your relationships to your own memories in the context of PTSD. Ultimately, I think what we're seeing is the potential for large-scale behavior change enabled by a sense of agency, a sense that one has the ability to change their own behavior, an increase in the sense of free will. And I think we all intuitively appreciate the role of conscious decision-making in our lives, regardless of psychedelics. And think about those times when you're inspired. You feel like a creative force in life. You have some ability to influence. And I'd argue many of our greatest challenges in society are related to conscious decision making, not just the mental health crisis and health generally, social media, our relationships to each other, our relationships to the environment, conflict resolution. So I think the challenge is how can we dive into this science of psychedelics and their potential to increase conscious decision-making and allow us to step into that mode of self-actualization? What would that science look like? Well, there are some ideas that you can draw from psychology and neuroscience. One example is, we know that we can use brain waves to detect when a person is going to make a voluntary action, even before that person is consciously aware that they're going to initiate that action. And that finding has been discussed for years in the context of the philosophical debate over free will. But what I'm interested in are, what would a psychedelic do to the timing of that awareness? There's also a phenomenon surrounding voluntary action where subjective time warps surrounding voluntary action. In other words, people's estimation of the time between an action that they take and a consequence from the environment tends to contract. It's a way that we psychologically bind our actions and their consequences in our perceptions of the world. How would a psychedelic experience and its aftermath affect that? In another line of research, instead of focusing on the treatment of particular psychiatric disorders, what about examining the effects of psychedelics on individuals who bring their own idiosyncratic behavior change goals to the study? And that way we can start to examine psychedelics as a generalized behavior change technology. I think these lines of research can help us bridge the gap between these intriguing findings in treating mental health disorders and a line of research that can really extend us into optimizing self-actualization. Unfortunately, this research agenda is not one that, understandably, companies developing psychedelics as medications are immediately interested in, nor is it an idea that lends itself towards government funding agencies, which tend to shy away from bold ideas. But I think despite these funding challenges to engage in this work, it's critical that we do this type of work. By leaning into this work to understand how psychedelics really affect our conscious decision-making, we really have an opportunity to learn about and to maximize human flourishing. Thank you.